It's a pretty fair bet that election 2016 has given college classrooms a lot to talk about. We've discussed on Need to Know, millennials are a coveted voting bloc. But to get anyone to show up to the polls on November 8th means they need to have some type of interest in the election, whether pleased or unimpressed with the candidates. Engaging millennials in the election process has been a focus for an area professor whose students will host a public policy forum open to the community just before Election Day. Joining me in the studio to talk Clinton, Trump, and much more is Wes Renfro, associate professor and chair of the Department of Political Science and Legal Studies at St. John Fisher College, and Fisher students Camille Pensabine and Gabriella Kielbasinski. Welcome to the show. So, Wes, I have to start with you, because I'm curious, did you ever imagine that an election cycle like the one we're experiencing would be in place as you're preparing your courses for spring and fall of 2016?
No. It's atypical. I love teaching during the election year. There's high student interest. There's always a lot to talk about. This time there has been much more than normal to talk about. It's been a really great experience.
In terms of student engagement, do you feel as though the conversations are a lot more enthusiastic this election year than in years past?
So I think that people like talking about sort of the horse race coverage.
Yeah.
I think that there's decreased enthusiasm for the candidates themselves.
Yeah.
And one of the things that's been really hard in terms of teaching is that normally we have a lot of give and take with liberal students advocating and conservative students advocating. And the thing that has struck me the most this cycle is that there are very few students who are willing, at least in public, to advocate for Donald Trump.
I remember when I was a college student, it was during the big Gore and Bush election, which proved to be very newsworthy post-election day. That was the very first time I had ever heard about accusations of vote rigging. But I want to know, for both of you, what does this election mean for you as students?
I think as students, this election is really important for most of us. I know for myself, at least, it's the first election I get to vote in. It's really exciting for me. And I think for me, this election means taking a really strong look at both candidates, trying not to get swept up in that horse race coverage, trying not to get swept up in the media, and really looking at what matters, policy, you know, what's of substance. I think that there has been a lot of almost Hollywood-like coverage of this election just because of the nature of the candidates and Donald Trump. And I just want to make sure what's important to me in this election is we focus on what matters, and that's where the candidate stands on issues. And obviously their character is a huge part of that too, but just not to get swept up in that Hollywood-like media coverage.
What about for you, Camille?
I agree with everything that Gabby said. I think it's, for me, it's also my first election voting, so that's really exciting. But then I think it's also important to acknowledge that whether or not you like her, it's exciting that there is a woman candidate that there is the potential to vote for. So whether or not she wins, whether or not you like her, it's history in itself that she can be elected and that we have that opportunity to vote for a woman.
Attracting the millennial vote, it's been a very, very big topic this election year. We talked about it quite a bit on the show. And I want to know, do you think that there's anything more to it besides the fact that your group makes up about on average 31% of the electorate? Or do you think it's something more than that? Do you think that the candidates are engaging you in particular and your wants and your needs and the changes that you want to see?
Something that we've talked a lot about in class is that millennials are often underrepresented just for a lot of reasons, whether or not they don't get out to vote, whether they're not informed enough to vote, or whether, because we're at college, we don't always get the absentee ballots. So I think it's important that we are having these conversations at college and that we're getting millennials more involved because we are such a big part of the electorate.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with everything Camille just said, and just to add that I do think that some candidates are certainly doing a better job than others appealing to the millennials. Specifically, I think Hillary Clinton is doing a better job than Donald Trump when she discusses, you know, college and the cost of college and certainly student debt, which is a big topic, I know, in my mind at least. I think that she's doing a much better job of reaching out and talking about issues that matter and are relevant to millennials versus Donald Trump. I don't see that same attention to detail from. So I would just say that, you know, the Republican Party for a long time has been trying to reach out to younger voters. That was something in the past they had said was a real priority. But in practice, I definitely see more Democratic and left-leaning groups touching upon issues that matter more to millennials versus Republicans. I would say maybe they have a higher concentration on issues that matter to elderly or like the senior population.
And some would say Hillary Clinton can thank Bernie Sanders for that, who had a lot of the millennial support.
Yeah.
So Wes, how do you teach the election, considering I would imagine there are challenges considering how contentious this election is between these candidates?
Yeah, it's actually been a little bit less contentious than I thought, because I think the students are tilting towards Clinton in general. But I do have this sense sometimes that you need to be sensitive to folks who are maybe not of that mindset. And I think it's quite similar to the media in some respects, right? I have to be an arbitrator in the classroom and not engage in advocacy teaching. That's not who we are. Yeah. So I think in my class in particular, we do a lot with data. We talk about polling. We talk about the institution of the presidency. We give historical examples. And you know, I'm an empiricist, and so the line of the students is always follow the data.
Got it. Well, we popped in your class earlier this week, and you were talking about the data as well. And I have a clip that I want to show our viewers just so they can hear a little bit about the reaction between the students and you. And Gabby, you make an appearance, so viewers will get to see you as well. So we'll take a look at this.
What are the two different ways in which he's saying rigged?
He's talked a lot about the media rigging it, the media being biased towards Hillary Clinton, but he's also recently, like Kellyanne Conway has come out and talked a lot about voter fraud with like dead people still being on the registration, and that's been a really big issue according to his campaign.
Recently, there has been this suggestion that, you know, that the polls themselves are rigged or that they're somehow not honest. Does anybody want to just comment on how difficult it would be to fix all those polls?
It's incredibly difficult. As far as we're concerned, I'm pretty sure, like after the studies have been done about voter fraud and fraud in the elections, it's only a case of about 0.1% of votes are actually fraudulent. And I mean, besides the point, you know, everyone has enough issues going out to vote once as it is, and it would have to be, you'd have to put a lot of effort into voting again and again and again.
So I understand that class begins each week with this open dialogue about whatever issues are going on at that present time with the campaign. I want to know, Camille, I'm going to give this to you. Have you learned anything from your professors or your peers that have made you rethink the election process, that it might be maybe swayed your vote, or kind of given you pause with the political process in general?
Yeah, so I'm actually an education major, so taking this class has been really eye-opening for me. I really didn't know that much about elections and the presidency in general, so for me this was a really big learning experience. I knew that the Electoral College existed, but I didn't really know exactly how it worked. And also, we have two professors, so we have Dr. Renfro, but we also have Dr. Donovan in our class, so getting both their perspectives on both the polling and the institution of the presidency has been really awesome. I've really learned a lot about it.
Well, you have been working with your students as your professor, that you, your colleague that you're working with, on this special public policy forum that will take place on November 3rd. It's open to the public, which will be great. And you've been breaking down policy proposals supported by the candidates Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. So how are you specifically preparing your students? Because we hear often there's just not enough detailed information when it comes to their policy proposals.
So we've divided the class into three groups, and they're going to tackle immigration, jobs, and terrorism. And they had to look at the candidate statements, both on their websites and then things that are attributed to them, and then also really find out what experts on those topics have had to say. We're asking them to think about the assumptions that are built into policies and things like unintended consequences. And I think that the students are doing pretty well, but most of them are also beginning to realize that crafting public policy is very difficult.
Are there any challenges that you hope to address through this forum when it comes to the public, when it comes to these specific policy proposals that you'll be bringing up?
One thing I would really hope that the public would be encouraged to do from this forum is be a little bit skeptical of promises made in policies. Yeah. I think oftentimes we see candidates promising things, even though they're promised with good intentions, that's really not in their power to necessarily fulfill those promises. So even if they're great ideas, they might find themselves unable to actually have those things come to fruition. My topic is immigration, so obviously there are some very strong policy stances in this election. I'm thinking specifically about Donald Trump with the wall, and a part of his plan to make Mexico pay for the wall is raising the price of visa fees. Now that's something that, you know, would have to go to Congress and go through that. So be skeptical that, you know, the president is not the be-all, say-all for policy. It goes through a lot of legislative channels, so just to think bigger picture.
It's a good point you bring up. I often want to do a show on that. Like, you know, the candidates say one thing, but let's circle back and see how many things have they been able to check off that list based on the promises that they're making, in particular when it comes to local elections. Well, we have to wrap for now, but I want to make sure that viewers have the information for the Public Policy Forum being hosted by Professor Renfro and his colleague and his students. It is open to the Rochester community, and it is sure to be an interesting event. It's happening on Thursday, November 3rd from 4 to 6 p.m. in the mid-level of the Golisano Gateway. That's at St. John Fisher College. Be sure to check it out.